My name is Zinat Islam, and I'm the Relations Manager, Academia Network. We will start today by watching a short video. Mr. Aziz, please kindly play the video. We are waiting to play the video. Please bear with us. Thank you very much. I welcome everyone again to today's session, The Role of Social Business in Post-COVID World. I'm happy to share today we have over 1,000 participants registered, and many will be joining us through our social media channels. Today's session will take the form of a fireside chat between Professor Mohammad Yunus and Dr. Aseem Chauhan. Dr. Aseem Chauhan is the Chancellor of Amity University and the trustee of the not-for-profit Amity Education Group India, which includes 10 world-class universities, 25 schools and preschools, 150 top-ranked institutions, and 15 international campuses across many countries. In today's session, there is no provision for Q&A, but we welcome everyone to please share your feedback, your comments, suggestions, and questions to our email address, ysbc@yunuscenter.org. Thank you very much, and I now give the floor to Professor Mohammad Yunus for his welcome speech. Thank you. Professor Yunus.
Hello, yes, yes. Okay, yeah, I hear. Yes, welcome to everybody. Welcome to our YSBC web lecture series. We are excited about it because this is the first time we are doing it and we have been thinking how would it go. So this is the first time we are doing that. And always it's a thrilling experience when we do something for the first time. And we see it's a long journey, but having the first step, we are taking the first step to do that. I hope you enjoy it. Today, everybody is familiar with the virtual gathering. Everybody is gathering virtually everywhere about the social gathering, about the business gathering, about the formal meetings and so on. And even the school children are having virtual gathering. So we thought, why not us? why don't we have our family members, social business family members gathering? So gathering, a virtual gathering of all. So this is what this is all about. It's a family gathering. So it's not a kind of a big serious discussions and from the podium or something like that. It's a gathering of our family members, those who are interested in social business, who are engaged in social business, who are curious about social business, young, old, very young, doesn't matter. We are all family members interested in the subject of social business, and we want to get together. Then when we get together, we can chat with each other. So we will have a fireside chat. This is the arrangement, the fireside chat for the family members. We pick an experienced family member, someone who did this social business for a long time, has lots of experience. We invite him or invite her to come and talk about it. And we gather around and kind of listen to a discussion, a fireside chat with person, and learn from him and see, and become interested in the subject, and to look for more and more issues coming out of it. So you feel free to find out who will be the next person you would like to talk to in the fireside chat, because this is a series that you'll choose persons and we'll have a subject for them, and you'll choose the subject too. And you'll ask the questions to our email address, keep sending those questions so that, and suggestions, who would you like to talk to? So we are very happy today. We are having the first one in that series, and we are very happy that we can continue with this. It will happen regularly every month. Twice a month, this is our idea, is a family gathering across the world throughout the network of YSBC, network of social businesses, network of organizations of young people, professional people, and so on. So this is the whole idea, a family gathering, sitting around in a social business fireside chat. And as a senior most member of the family, I have been chosen to be the first one to talk about. So I gladly accepted that. So this is what I'll do. And my good friend, Asim Chauhan, Amity University, Chancellor of Amity University. It's a wonderful person. You'll get to know him and see how fantastic person he is. He agreed to be the moderator, the kind of leading the chat with me. So I'm very happy to sit down with him in the fireside and talk about it. So I'll let Asim jump in and start the process of fireside chat. Whatever he wants to talk about, I'll be very happy to talk to you, Asim. So yeah. The floor is yours, Asim.
Professor Yunus, it is always so wonderful to see you, to hear from you. You inspire millions of people all around the world. And whenever we have the pleasure to meet you, we get motivated and inspired. We are honored that you have selected us and me for the first YSBC lecture series to talk to you. It is a great opportunity, and I'm sure this will be a very successful series of talks that you are curating personally. When we were planning for this, you said, Asim, let us have a cordial, friendly discussion amongst friends and family. And we are so proud that you consider us as Amity part of your family, and we are so proud that you are part of our family. It is truly always wonderful to interact with you.
I'm absolutely delighted to be your friend and your system of Amity Universities.
Yes. Professor Yunus, you know, we will get into the topic of social business and the impact of that, especially in the current COVID world. But many people want to know, how are you doing? A Nobel laureate, one as active as you, how does one do work from home in this scenario? You like to travel, you like to do so much around the world. In Munich on Social Business Day, you had organized a mega show. So clearly it is not slowing you down. How are you doing personally, Professor Yunus?
Well, as you said, locked down inside my home and for a few months now. But our activity has not stopped. It's amazingly, the activity around the world has not stopped either. So today we are active in our social media. We are active in the virtual world. I've been talking to people, addressing people in many different countries, many different ways. So we continue to do that. And many interviews come on in the newspapers and so on. I keep promoting the issues of social business in the context of corona pandemic. It's very important issues that have been raised. I hope we will get a chance to talk about this. So I remain active, and I feel good that I can reach out to so many people in so many distant places. When it's happening, It would have taken days to get there and make arrangements for the passport, visa, and the ticket, and go there, immigration, hotel, and finally give a lecture for 45 minutes or 1 hour. Then you come back or have a little dinner, or breakfast or something. Today I can do, in a way, in four continents in the same day, speaking to four mega events without leaving my home. So that's another new experience, a new dimension that you can organize yourself to do things in a much bigger scope. Even when the paralysis is coming, the pandemic is coming, you find your way. People have to be creative, that's all.
Well, wonderful, wonderful. And the pandemic has impacted people in many different ways. It has impacted individuals and businesses. People are worried about lives and livelihood. Professor Yunus, what is the relevance of social business in this COVID-19 world that we are in today?
Yeah. See, one thing that I observe in the pandemic situation and watching the news and the television, reading the newspapers and all the information that I get, suddenly this pandemic has stopped the whole world. It's an amazing force with this speed of lightning speed, attacked the whole world and conquered the whole world in less than 100 days. And the world is under their thumb. And we within this period, we thought we'll behave in a certain way to fight the common enemy for the whole world in a common strength, standing together side by side. But that's not what happened. It's very disappointing. And it showed how selfish we are, how tribal we are. We went back to our tribalism rather than our global unity to fight common enemy for human beings on the planet itself. So that was very revealing that the inside of it is still very strong in us, how to overcome that, because we have to fight common enemies in a common way. This is one. Another thing Corona has done, it revealed all the weaknesses in our societies, in our economy, in our thinking processes. These were there, we are aware of it. Sometimes we talk about it, but we have not seen it in right in front of our eyes. It revealed it. We have a visual now of the entire weaknesses, a spectrum of weaknesses the society has. And Indian situation was very strongly presented in that one to the media, about millions of people walking to home 1,000 miles away because they have no livelihood, they have no income, they cannot pay for their food, they cannot pay for their rent. So India is a big country, it's a big number coming in the highway to walk home in 1,000 miles. But every country is going through the same process, may not be as dramatic as it was in India. In Bangladesh, same thing happened. All the garment workers going home once and coming back another time without any transportation and so on, suffering every kind of humiliation of survival. So the survival issue came very, very strong. That's why a debate began between whether it's a life or the livelihood. Right. And my position always been, this is, life has no option. So there is no question about debating about life or livelihood. Right. Life is unique. We have to protect the life first, then everything else comes. But all these weaknesses of the informal sector, people who live day by day, daily income, next day you don't have income, you're finished, you don't know. And if your little savings are eaten up in a few days and you are absolutely out in the street, hungry, that's a dramatic thing that we have seen. So I would say, in short, the corona pandemic has revealed a massive way the weaknesses that we have in our thinking, in organizing our society, in organizing our economy. So this is the time to inspect that and see that why how we led to this situation. So this is the important lesson for the corona vaccine.
Wonderful.
Corona pandemic.
Yeah. Let me follow on to this thought, Professor Yunus, that recently you had said that this crisis is also an opportunity, and an opportunity that we must not let go. You had further said that we must not go back to the world the way it was earlier. We have many people from all over the world on here today who have tuned in. Many of them are from YSB centers. We have many young people also. We have many top researchers from around the world. We have many Amitians from different universities who are currently listening. Could you help elaborate What is your vision and what do you mean that we cannot go back to the old world, we must build a new world? What does this mean in your words?
One thing, as I mentioned, that it revealed all the weaknesses in our society. At the same time, it has stopped the whole economic machine. The engine is a stop. So I said, this is a wonderful thing, that the thing that we couldn't have done, Corona has done it for us. We were heading for a big disaster in our old days before the Corona pandemic came in. We were rushing to our disaster. And that's what we have been complaining about. It is only a few months back, by the end of December, the whole Corona story began. And until then, we were riding away in a big speed and higher speed and rushing to our ultimate destruction. So we are, the whole world that we built was a self-destructive world and coming to the finishing line very soon. So soon that our young children in our families, the teenagers, were marching on the street saying that, accusing their parents, their grandparents for creating this world in a way they have left no opportunity for survival for the young generation because of the global warming. And global warming is hitting us in a big way and it will not give us one decade or two decades more to for survival, because by year 2050, probably the whole story will be over. So we are rushing to that. I said, this is almost like a riding a train in a very high speed, all of us inside the train, and the train destination of the train is the finishing line where the world ends. Human habitation on this planet ends because of the global warming. And Corona was, what Corona has done, luckily for us, stopped the train. This train cannot move anymore. So we got a chance to get off the train. We don't want to ride the death train, which takes us to the massive destruction and death. So this is an opportunity. It was not only the global warming, it's also about the wealth concentration. All the wealth concentration was taking place so fast. And we are saying that this is a ticking time bomb. It can explode anytime. So we are heading for that explosion nearer and nearer as we move on, as the train was moving in that direction. Today, Corona has stopped the train. And then the problem of massive unemployment through artificial intelligence, that is also heading us to the destruction because all human beings would be out of jobs, without out of income and so on. I said, we should be grateful to Corona pandemic for making this train stop. Now we can get off and build another train, another track to go someplace else, because going back will be suicidal. It will be insane, totally insane to go back to where we know for sure this is not the right place. So I said, our basic decision right now should be no going back. It should be a very solid decision. And on that decision, no going back, and then we have to find out where to go. We know where to go. It's very clear because it's everything that's happening to the old world, we should not repeat it in the new world. So the new world will be world of three zeros. Zero net carbon emission, zero wealth concentration, zero massive unemployment. So those three zeros will be our goal, and we can rebuild the entire situation, redesign the entire thinking process, and redesign the institutions to make us go there. And that's where the social business comes in very strongly, very attractive alternative. It's already been designed, already been working. So we can design all this institution in the light of the social businesses. That's where the importance of the social business comes out. So I'll stop here and let you lead me to in any direction you would like me to.
I want to, you know, take a little bit more of a deeper look into this. I was seeing that in our audience today, we have some very influential, very accomplished people. I saw Dr. Nagpal, Dr. Gurinder Singh, Professor P.B. Sharma from Singapore, Professor Leon Chung. These are all people who can have a deep impact. I was wondering, Professor Yunus, that you have given us a dream for this new world that can be there. How can such people and so many young people out there, how can they affect this change? And what is it, a policy decision at government level? Is it individual? Is it business people? Who can be part of this new world and how to do it?
I would say all of us, whoever is here, it's a death and life question. So it's not a question that just because you're in the government, you should be thinking about our life. We don't pay attention to our life. That's not true. Right. I should be concerned about my life. My children should be concerned about their lives. And I should be concerned about my family, my children, my grandchildren, and everybody else. So this is the simple question of life and death. It's one side is the death another side is a life, hope. So you say, I don't know how to go to the life. I said, we have to discover it. We have plenty of opportunities. And I give the example. I think it makes sense easily. I said, we know exactly why global warming is happening. Scientists told us everything about the global warming, how it happens, who makes it, how much each is contributing. It's all listed. Right. So if you don't want to make global warming, stop them.
Yes.
Stop the people who are making the global warming. I said, this is a very funny situation. We know, and then we complain that why the global warming. I said, it's like if I'm becoming obese and I'm getting fatter and fatter, and I hate it, but I don't want to change my diet. See? So I know what is the problem. What is the problem, what is the solution, but I don't want to go into it. So I continue to become obese and all the trouble that I can get to. So if I want to have a good health, I have to control my diet. I have to take care of my health. I have to exercise. So that's what we don't want to do. We don't want to stop the fossil fuel. We don't want to stop the plastic. We don't want to make this economy as a circular economy. These are all known. These are not unknown things. So the train has stopped. Now we can go strongly that forget it. We are not going to get away. So in the new world that we have, all we have to do is to have a check post so that fossil fuel cannot go into it, so that plastic cannot get through it. So we know them. So if we know, we have to be very tough. This is the time to take the toughest decisions of our lives in the entire world. So it's every single individual. And the persons that you mentioned, they are very powerful thought leaders. If they can start thinking, if they can influence thinking, everybody said, yes, we do that. Because in our families, we have business people, we have academic people, we have all kinds of people. It's us with the same family. So if you can contain one person in our family that please don't do that, because you're destroying our life and the children, life of our children and so on. We have to promise to ourselves that we have to hand over this planet as a much more safe planet to our children. And with a promise, they will hand it over to their children still safer than what they found it. This is the direction we got. Today we are doing just the reverse. We make it worse than what we found and hand it over to our children. And they are our children is trained to make it still worse and hand it to them. And it's ultimate death. This is not the option. So we know that. Well, death is very clear. It's a very simple direction. Everybody is unanimous about it. There's nobody questioning that idea. But we, as I said, the obese person doesn't want to do on the diet. We have to go on to diet. That's the only thing.
We have to know what to do. We want to do it. And you've given a positive, optimistic view of what the world could be. I think many people will be inspired by this vision that there is so much that we can do. Professor Yunus, I want to ask you about a specific agenda that you have been pursuing, and it has got a lot of media attention all over the world. I've been reading about it, hearing about it from many different quarters, and it is that you made a global appeal to declare the corona vaccine, any vaccine that is developed, as a global common good. In a document I read that you also called it a public common good. You have had a very large number of world leaders from politics and business that have signed up for this appeal. So I would like to ask you, what is this appeal? What is it looking for? Why is it important to make a corona vaccine a global common good? How do we achieve this? If you can please address this.
Yeah, I was very worried, right? As you said, worried that... how to stop this corona keep on expanding. One thing, that end will come if you can find the vaccine. All the people, the medical people, health people saying vaccine is the ultimate thing because we can protect each individual with the vaccine. So if we start taking that vaccine, then corona cannot touch us anymore. So that vaccine has to be used by every single person on this planet so that we can totally block them out. If we leave some, then corona continues. It will spread again to somebody and somewhere else. So we have to make sure that we do that. Then when we started thinking, one process is the health research process to come up with this idea and the kind of recipe for the vaccine, what would be the medical content of that. Another one is to produce it and make it available. There I got into trouble. I see now the big companies are jumping around to make big money. There's a half a dozen companies in the world who make practically all the big healthcare products in the world. So, and they will be the one who will be doing that. And they already done that. It's a USA has bought huge number of vaccines for itself. So again, it becomes a selfish one. They say vaccine nationalism. Our vaccine is the first. forget about the rest of it. So USA is buying up all the vaccines within the, produced within the United States, even buying up from the Europeans, like the Sanofi from France and others, and the Glaxo, and so on. And UK is buying up from Glaxo, from AstraZeneca, and so on. They are all for their own country, buying up, using huge amount of money, billions of dollars, paying in advance. I said, if this goes on, if the rich people buy up all the vaccines, what happens to the rest of the people? Then we thought we should make an appeal that it should not be protected by any patent right. Patent right is the ownership controlled by the big companies. If you release it from that, then other companies can come out and start producing it at the cheap, because now that you're not a stat, because big companies want to make super profit out of it. And they're not worried about the people's situations and so on. I give the example HIV/AIDS, when antiretroviral came out. First time it was $30,000 per person. And soon it came down to $3,000 and stayed there. But $3,000 couldn't be afforded by people in most of the countries. So India and others got together and brought it to the level that they started making it for $300. And now it became generic, it's only $3 per person. So $30,000 to $3 per piece. And that's what the vaccine is all about. Vaccine could be sold and it's as cheap as $3. Now we are hearing that it's being negotiated with $3,000 plus kind of per person, per dose, et cetera, et cetera. So I said, if we make it public good or patent free, no commercial ownership into it, then it will be possible to produce locally. Today it's controlled by a few companies. Now that control will be over. Then it will be available to everybody else. So this is what we are focusing on. After we did that and the 150 world leaders signed it, and then we see the tremendous response to our appeal. And now we are going to promote a UN resolution for it. So we are going around, and I invite all of you who are listening to this presentations, discussions, to help us to bring to your respective government to convince them to support this UN resolution. We'll circulate it to you if you ask it. We'll send you a copy of the UN resolution. So we are going to individual country to lobby with them to sponsor this UN resolution. UN resolution simply says it should be declared as a common good, as a public good, so that there is no commercial interest ownership. And we give examples. Polio vaccine. When polio vaccine was done by, developed by Jonas Salk, he made it very clear that he doesn't want any ownership of this. It will be public good. It will be people's vaccine. Right. Nobody should own it. And that's how polio vaccine became very easy. Now polio has been overcome. We are creating a polio-free world. We're almost finished at the line because of the vaccine availability of that vaccine. So it's not a new thing we are suggesting, simply tradition to continue. So this is what we're appealing to everybody to support this and make sure your government sponsors this.
Wonderful. I saw just online that Dr. Selva Murthy is online. He's one of the top life sciences scientists of India. Very close to the government. Dr. Selva Murthy, I will speak to you after the call. Maybe we can make a program to take this agenda to the government, and we know all the people. So I will take this up, but it's a wonderful dream. Professor Yunus, you are facing a big challenge with all these pharmaceutical companies, billions of dollars.
I know.
Do you think that an appeal, a social appeal, can stand ground against all this business and profit world that there is on the other side?
We have all the people on our side. That's the biggest chunk. It's billions of people together. So it's when people want something done, it gets done. So one is to get the United Nations to kind of have a resolution. That alone will not solve the problem. But still, each government can come and say that here's the UN resolution, we're going to implement it. And this is another one. And luckily for one, there are countries who have made it already that it will be a social good. They will not have it as a kind of control by any commercial interest or anything. So this is a departure. I hope other countries will follow that procedure, that declaring vaccine as a common good and make it available in the market and make it sure. So this is the kind of process that we have to build, and it has to be a tradition that's to be built. And also we discuss about, this is another thing I'd like to discuss with you later on also, create a social business pharmaceutical company, global social business pharmaceutical company. Why do we have to wait for those people who are producing it now? Why can't we produce it ourselves? Is it because of the money, because of the skill? The skill is available. People will be delighted to come and join us. All the experts will be delighted to come into social business pharmaceutical company. All the researchers will be delighted to contribute their inventions to produce, give it to the social business pharmaceutical company. So let's design that. Let's make a start of that social business pharmaceutical company. So that in our case, we are not the ownership, we are for the people, so that everybody gets it. And I remind people that if you cannot produce it and distribute it worldwide, then there's a big risk of fake vaccines. There are a lot of fake vaccines will be floating around the market. And another round of money, billions of dollars made by fake people who want to just make money, forget about what people's life deserves and so on. So this is an opportunity for us. That's why Corona has given us lots of opportunity. Let's not miss it.
Wonderful. Such wonderful, beautiful words. And I think many people listening would not have thought in this direction. I'm sure they're inspired with these words and it will take them to new directions. Prasiones, before I ask a few final questions about social business and COVID-19, a big objective of what I wanted to achieve today is to inspire young people who are online.
Yes, of course. Yes,
also change the world in some way. So can we know a little bit about your life, maybe something about your childhood? How are your parents? Did they inspire you? What was your journey like? And when did you get this enlightenment that, yes, I can change the world. I can do something so dramatic that millions of people will be benefited. When did that enlightenment come? How did that come to you? How did you take it forward? I'm hoping that some young person listens to it and tries to do something big also.
Thank you. Well, I'm just an ordinary Bangladeshi rural kid. I grew up in the rural area, started in a school who's sitting on the floor and yelling words and learning by rote how to learn. This is how my beginning has happened. And my family is a low middle class family in the rural area with a big family of the 7 brothers and 2 sisters. Grew up together, fighting with each other. That was a wonderful, wonderful way to grow up. We are on our own. Our parents couldn't control us. We are so many of us. So we did whatever we wanted to do and get through. And our parents were very lovely parents. They always supported us, whatever we wanted to do. They didn't have much education, so they wanted to make sure that their children have education. Their high school dropouts and primary school dropout, that kind of thing. So they didn't have much of it. But the intense interest in having their children to go to school. And whatever little means they have, they wanted to make sure they go to school, neighborhood school. It's a very very low-level school, very not a good teacher or anything. Go through it. Since my parents were, particularly my father was busy with this little business that he was running, we were free people. We children grew up our own way. We designed our things. So that helped us a lot. We are very sort of self-reliant. We right. did things on our own way, continue to do that. And luckily it worked well in a school. We did very, all of us did very good in school. All our brothers and sisters finished their college, finished their universities, coming from that level of education and so on from my parents. And then luckily for me as an individual among the 7, I got lots of opportunities. I was performing well in school. And also I was a Boy Scout. As a Boy Scout, I was traveling all the time. So I traveled India, I traveled Pakistan, I traveled many other countries. Then I got an opportunity to travel to Canada to attend the Jamboree when I was still a kid, a 15-year-old kid. Then went to Jamboree in Canada, then traveled all over Europe through buying some 3 microbuses for the Scout Association, Pakistan Scout Association. And we drove these microbuses through all of Europe to come back home instead of wasting money on the plane fare. So their smart people thought, why don't we just use the money to buy the microbuses and you can drive through. And it took us 6 months. We are of our own decision. So we decided which city we go, which country we go. It took 6 months to travel through Europe and coming back. So that's an exciting thing. And that gave us a lot of freedom. And education helped me. And always I tried to do something new in my own way. And that helped me to see things in a different way. I became a teacher. I wanted to explore things in my own way, defy the normal standard kind of formula of economics and so on. I tried to do it in my way. That's how the microcredit came. That's how the social business came. All those things came after one after another. And I was not shy of doing things which was not known to anybody or not known to myself either. But I thought this should be done and went ahead, and luckily it was done.
Wonderful, amazing. So to all the young people listening, a life of curiosity, exploration, innovation, and hard work. I think if you follow that dream, you can also achieve big ideas in social business or otherwise. Prasenj, thank you for sharing this personal side of yours. I had also not heard some of these things. I'm one of six siblings. We have six of us,
so I can appreciate we're very close.
Big family. It is always a lot of enjoyment.
A lot of fun, lot of fighting.
Yeah, lot of fighting, lot of togetherness, and I
think of course,
growth with that. I wanted to ask you, Professor Yunus, that I have seen that there are many people that have joined your mission. I saw that on Social Business Day from all over the world, people sent in messages. I don't think any country was left out. The senior most people were together with you. Who are the kind of people, who are the kind of groups that are joining with you? What is their role in taking your mission and your thoughts forward? Because I'm trying to see, many people are online, and maybe it can give them an idea also what more they can do for this.
Yeah, so varieties of people. Like, for example, we work with the French Olympic. So all the Olympic people in France, the whole team, that France is Paris is the location for Olympic 2024. And I was saying that Olympic can be designed as a social business. So they agreed to that, they accepted that, and they involved me to design it as a social business. So I'm part of that designing. And we competed with other cities and went to Switzerland in the IOC headquarters to present the French case. I was part of the delegation from the French delegation, and other delegation came. We made our presentation from French side, they made their presentation from Los Angeles. And finally, Paris got it as a social business, Olympic. So we are very close to, for example, Mayor of Paris, Anne Hidalgo. She is the first one who said that, yes, he agreed with me. I said, athletics is a big force. Sports is a big force, but it's not used for social purpose. It's used for only entertainment, only for commercial purposes. They make money by advertising and so on, but nothing. I said, this is something which appeals to every single human being on this planet, rich, poor, doesn't matter. They get emotionally charged with that. Why can't you use it for social purposes? So that's the whole idea, how to use athletics and sports as a social purpose, social designs and so on. So now we are involved with it. IOC president, Thomas Bach, became my chief promoter. This is the idea that we have to transform everything. So he goes around talking about it every time he talks about that. And he promotes this idea of vaccine. He is one of the first one to sign this global good vaccine. And he convinced Macron. He talked to Macron. He said, Macron said, we signed it. We made a public statement that, yes, we support it's a vaccine as a public good. So this is the kind of direction. You see many leading people in governments, the prime ministers, presidents, supporting the idea of social business. Then you have the business people, the top business people like Danone, the chairman of Danone, the owner, majority owner of Danone, he immediately said, I want to do social business myself. I'm very convinced with what you are doing. So created Grameen Danone Company as a social business to bring nutrition to the malnourished children in a social business way, so that the company doesn't have any profit for anybody, but it approaches the children who are malnourished. And a massive number of children are malnourished. So this is a special kind of yogurt that we produce with all the micronutrients mixed into it. Vitamin, iron, zinc, iodine, and everything, and make it very cheap so that poor families can achieve that. So this is the kind of thing. McCain, another big company, it's a family-owned company, became very convinced that they want to do social business. So they created several social businesses in Europe, in Colombia, and so on. Throw away potatoes. There's a potato company, McCain. They throw away bulk of the potato, 40% of the potato is thrown away because they do not give the largest number of French fry per potato. So right. They're looking for the size which is appropriate for the French fry. So they do it. So when they become social business friends, they created a separate company for buying up all those throw away potatoes and make potato soup. Is it how stupid of us? Why didn't we think about that before? Because we are the potato guy in the whole world. We control the 60% of the potato business in the whole world. And we are throwing away potato. It's a good food. Now you gave us the idea that nothing should be thrown away. So we made it into soup. So it's a soup company became family. So now they are buying up all the vegetables, throw away vegetables. There's again 36% of the vegetables are thrown away because they are not the right shape. Shape plays a very important role in vegetables. If you're not in the military formation of vegetables in the supermarket, nobody wants to buy it. If a banana is a little crooked, nobody will buy it. So you'll never see any crooked banana in your superstore. So they've thrown away. So what they have done, they started buying up all those, they call it in the technical term of the business, they call it ugly vegetables. It's an official name for this vegetable, ugly vegetables. So they now buy up all those ugly vegetables, make into vegetable soup. See, it's very simple solution. It's a good food. And then they cut off these vegetables into little pieces and make it a little packet, call this ready-to-cook food, ready-to-cook vegetables. It's a still thing, but once you chop it up into little pieces, then you don't see the shape. Yeah. Your shape is gone, then everything is okay with everybody. So see the idea. This is nothing new. You do the things within your own business. You don't have to go out of your business. And you do tremendous things. You talk about food shortage, and we threw away 40% of potato and 36% of vegetables by calling it names. Yes. So this is the kind of thing. So we have lots of connections, like in Japan, the Uniqlo is a super company, the retailing business. Yes. So they became very impressed with the Inai-san, the CEO of the company and the owner of the company. He said, I would like to do social business. So what he does in his garment factories, he picks up all the throwaway pieces of clothes and make clothes for the poor people, affordable way. Beautiful design, uniquely designed, but the poor people, only at the cost of the pieces of the cloth that you wear. So that it's a social business, you know, the free gift. They have a store, there are 11 stores in Bangladesh now, just selling those kind of things as a social business. So okay, there are many things can be done.
Wonderful. I think these are amazing ideas. I think many people would not have known the reach and the different strategic alliances and connections that are there as part of this social business movement. This is very inspiring. We are just approaching out of time, Professor Yunus. We could go on for hours, I know that, but today we have 45 minutes. Let me just ask you that, maybe last question, that for all of the students and people associated with the Yunus Social Business Centers all around the world, and there are so many of them, we at Amit University have a number of them and we'll have more also. Two questions. One, you mentioned some of these ideas. Are there any sectors within social business that from everything you're hearing, you would recommend to them and say, these are some high impact areas that in today's world you can or should look at? And number two, do you have any general message for all of these young people off the YSBCs all around the world? What message would you give to them to inspire them and to drive them?
Well, the first one I'll quickly make about the young people, the college and school, wherever they are. I would say, look, our education system is built in a way that you're trained to find a job for yourself. When you get a good job, it's settled, you're done. So I try to remind you that the job is not the destiny of any human being. That's not what the human beings are born for. Human beings are natural entrepreneurs, a creative people. They do things which were not done before. They do things in a way which were not done before. These are the things that do. Job is the one you repeat. Somebody guides you, somebody instructs you, you repeat. Repetition is not the best thing for a human being. Human being is to expand itself. It's a huge, huge creative machine. It always comes up with new things. So you discover yourself as entrepreneurs. And instead of trying to find a job, why don't you grow as an entrepreneur and build as an entrepreneur? So I invite all the unemployed young people, think about starting a business. And we create social business venture capital fund. And say, if you need the money, we'll give you the money. We'll invest in your business. This is our job. So to provide that financing, we started that. So think about those kind of situations, how we do that, how we persuade companies to create social business venture capital fund so that you can become entrepreneurs and do things in your own way and contribute. And it's, if you want to do in the social business, healthcare is an enormous area. Healthcare, through pandemic, we already learned our public healthcare system is an empty box. Yes. It didn't provide us anything. When we opened it, we didn't find much to brag about. So, and also healthcare as a system is not a very poor friendly or people friendly healthcare system. So how to design a poor friendly and people friendly healthcare system, women friendly healthcare system, so that we can have this healthcare system, which is something that I can afford, I can play, I can live with it. It's not a threatening thing, it's a friendly thing, we grow together. So this is where the digital healthcare thing comes. This is where all the healthcare hospitals comes in, the new ideas of hospital systems to do that. And not to make profit for yourself, it's a social business, just to cover the cost. And that's where the social business pharmaceutical company comes in. So that even the medicine becomes a social business venture, social business medicine. So that the cost is not, you don't charge $10 for a medicine which costs you only 10 pennies or a dime.
Yes.
You could tell, this is what we do with packaging and advertising and persuading, bribing, and all the thing goes around with the medicine companies and so on. So how to make that happen? It's all our will. If I do it, I don't have to wait for anybody else. I can do it here myself. And if I do it, somebody else get excited. Yes, I can do better. So somebody else comes in. So we create examples after examples. And what I should say to the young people in general, I said, this is the greatest opportunity no other generation ever had, pandemic. Pandemic gives you a clean slate. You start wherever you want to run because it will never happen. You will always be on the running train.
Right.
Today, there is no running train. This is a stop train. You go any direction you want.
Yeah.
So this is your choice. And make sure, and if you make up your mind, nobody can stop you. Nothing is impossible for human mind. So you make feel absolutely free. You are a privileged young people having such a great opportunity. You are a privileged young person, boys and girls. You are a privileged one because you are born with enormous technology in your hand. No other generation has so much technological power in their hand as soon as they are born. And suddenly, you can go up in the air anytime you want. It's not 50 years back, it could be possible. And 50 years later, what you do is simply makes you a superhuman being. Discover yourself as a superhuman being and ask yourself, if you are a superhuman being, what is the super work that you'll do? Because you don't have to do the normal human work. That is obsolete. You are designed for a super work. Do that super work. And that's your destiny. Make sure you keep up with that destiny. Don't deviate from that.
Wonderful. Professor Yunus, with these very inspiring words, let me thank you on behalf of all of the viewers here today, but also on behalf of all of our students, faculty, and administrators of Amity University. You know that we are very much aligned with you. You are an asset for mankind. We are all grateful to you that you have dedicated your whole life to helping others. And it is truly remarkable to hear from you, and your words will carry through these almost 1,000 people to many, many more, and light the minds, to ignite the minds, and to give ideas. So we are thankful to you. And I would like to give it to Zenith to close the session, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Asim. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Very kind. On behalf of our founder president, Dr. Ashok Chauhan, my father, he pays regards to you. He was remembering you a lot. He must be
thank you. Working,
but he is saying hello to you.
Please give my regards to him. Thank you very much. You are so kind.
Hello, everyone. This is Zenith again. Thank you, Dr. Chauhan. Thank you, Professor Yunus. This has been an extraordinary and very informative session. I extend my sincerest appreciation to all our audience members. Thank you for joining in. Now we would like to take a group photo. We will wait 10 seconds, and so everyone can take a group photo. If you scroll your screen, you will see all the audience members, and let's take a group photo.
Zenith, I would say anyone who has their video off, if they can, they can turn their videos on so that they appear in the photograph.
Yeah. Oh, yes. That'll be great.
Yes. I think we have captured our shots. Again, I would like to thank everyone for being a part of this session. This is just the first session of many more to come. Our upcoming session is on September 7th with, you can see on the screen, it's on September 7th, and it's on the topic of digital healthcare with Professor Cam Donaldson of Glasgow Caledonian University and Mr. Sajid Rahman from Digital Healthcare. So we look forward to having you join us in those sessions. And these YSBC Web Lecture Series sessions will be taking place twice a month on the first and the third Monday, unless otherwise stated. So please join us. Information about the sessions can be found on our social businesspedia and our social media channels. Thank you very much. And we look forward to having you in our upcoming sessions. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.